Good evening, everyone. Honorable Chairperson Mr. Pankaj Mohindroo, Chairman, India Cellular and Electronics Association, ICEA, distinguished speakers and delegates. It's my pleasure to extend you all a very warm welcome for joining us today for 27th edition of this magnificent show, Convergence India 2019. I request all of you to please silence your mobile devices. I would take this opportunity to briefly introduce our chairperson, Mr. Pankaj Mohindroo. Mr. Pankaj Mohindroo is the chairman of the India Cellular and Electronics Association, ICEA, the apex industry body representing the entire electronic sector in India. Mr. Mohindroo is a tall and renowned industry leader who is widely respected and honored among the highest political, administrative, and industry leadership corridors in India, considering his unparalleled contributions and unquenchable spirit to drive forward the Make in India and Digital India flagship programs of the Government of India, launched under stewardship of the Honorable Prime Minister, Mr. Narendra Modi. I would like to invite the chairperson, Mr. Pankaj Mohindroo, to come forward and briefly introduce our panelists and take over the session, Electronics Manufacturing in India, Challenges to Accelerate its Success.
I'd like to request the panelists to please, and the keynote speaker to come on the stage. First of all, I'll request the General Joint Secretary, Electronics, Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, Mr. Sanjay Rakesh, who is the keynote speaker today. Mr. Soundarakumar from CDOT, welcome. Sanjiv, Narayan, welcome. Khair, Nissa, welcome. Deepak, Thakkar, welcome. Electronic manufacturing is a very important program of Government of India, and we've met with some success. And one of the persons, key persons responsible for that is the person on my right, who is going to be the keynote speaker now, Mr. Sanjay Rakesh, who is the leader from the government side to lead the electronic industry. Sanjay ji has a vast experience of 25 years with Government of India and the state government. He's been Joint Secretary, Ministry of Rural Development, and Principal Secretary, Power in the Government of Tripura. He's also been a director on the board of several corporations, including National Housing Banks, ONGC Power Limited. I think he's today shouldering one of the most important responsibilities in our country, that is to take India forward in electronic manufacturing. So I'll request Sanjay ji to give his valuable thoughts as the keynote speaker.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Pankaj ji. Thank you for a very warm and illustrated introduction. Today I am supposed to say a few words about the challenges of electronics manufacturing and how to accelerate the success that we have achieved in the last few years. So I think it would be a repetition just to say that since ITA 1 came in, the Indian electronics industry had gone through a downhill, and only in the last few years, through certain measures taken or probably the geopolitical situation turning around or a combination of all, things have started turning around and we have seen some good successes, though it's still in the initial stages. And in the successes which have come, there have been government initiatives, industry support, and the drive of the industry to come up to a certain scale beyond what was seen earlier. So some very off-quoted statistics, in fact, production has grown by more than 26% CAGR in last 4 years, which was just about 6 to 7% in the previous to that. There have been multiple sectors which have shown a good promise. Mobile has been the poster boy, but there have been other sectors also like TV and LED, which has shown a great initial traction and growth. So while we are looking at that, there are still the challenges. We have our ecosystem yet very nascent and not developed to the maturity. Most of our products have low value addition and dependence on import is very high. In fact, the fear is that if the current trend continues, even if it continues at the pace that we are, in few years, import of electronic goods would take over the import of oil. So there is a need which is felt everywhere across the industry, the government, and all the decision makers, that there is a need to further accelerate. And accelerate the successes that we have done, we have achieved in last few years. But there are challenges. So that if we sum up those or briefly mention those challenges, the first we see, we can narrate the few very obvious ones, that we don't have ecosystem, we do not have our legal framework and policy setup that facilitates our logistics, power and financial disabilities are important, and they hurt from further growth. But if we see in a larger perspective, the challenges are the challenges when we grow from a professional system to a non-professional system to a professional system. The way we work, both industry and government, is that we don't understand each other. The few days back, a gentleman very highly placed in one industry came, and he was, of course, little upset because there was delay in his MCIP proposal. So he said, METI is creating trouble for us when government has agreed in principle to give me the money. So I could not understand. I told him it's the METI which has brought the scheme and it's a METI which has brought the procedures. So while scheme is okay in principles, is committed, but procedure is also part of the scheme. The procedure has to be gone through. And there would be delay. There are certain. So the basic issue is we need to understand, as an industry, we need to understand how the government works. It's our government. How we elect every 5 years and then there is a setup which works. And it has certain strength, certain weaknesses, which we all understand. Even if it's a China, Chinese system cannot be imported and transplanted here and become a successful. We have to have our own system grown in the ground, in the uniqueness of our own thing, and then only it can work. So when we deal with the government, we should understand how the government works. It's your government, our government, so if it works inefficiently, it works inefficiently. Similarly, from the government side, it has to understand the way the industry works. If there are 25 requirements to start an industry and 24 are met with quick response, even one delay, it cannot start. But there would be 24 departments coming forward and saying everywhere I did my promptly, but industry did not do because it had bad intentions. Nobody knows the 25th is the culprit, not the person who has started the factory. So possibly, and then there is an issue of mistrust. The one person does the wrong thing, everybody else then suffers. Here the issue is, which I find very strange, which is true with the society as a whole, not only with the industry. While we love bewitching, we love making complaints here and there, but when it comes pointing out to somebody within your neighborhood who does violate the law or who does something which is immoral, unethical, we become the three monkeys of Gandhiji and we believe somebody else will come and catch him. Nobody asks anybody else to go and fight with him, But raising the voice or even telling somebody else in confidence in some of your colleagues are doing something wrong which will hurt the industry as a whole is in the fine things of the work, the way it works. But it seems industry and industry associations take very biased view in the sense if my members are going against the law or against the procedure or they are creating moral hazards, it's not my job to even think of that. Somebody else will come and catch, because catching is somebody. Now somebody else catches. If he catches, then he applies it to everybody. So this basically is an issue of ecosystem. Now over a period, we are seeing that it's improving. The degree of professionalism now I see in associations, when I used to see 4 or 5 years back, is much improved. So that shows that we are growing. Then things are coming. The India has improved in rank in ease of doing business. The focus is known. Initially, for the electronic sector, the 3 items were stated to be very crucial for the non-competitiveness of industry: the power, the logistics, and the finance cost. Now I am told the power costs have come down at par with many other parts of the world. In fact, it's possible to go a little innovative and reduce the cost further. We have certain things which we are working with subtly with the state governments and all, and it's possible to reduce the cost even further. Logistics, it's still a bottleneck, but things are improving. If you are aware, recently a division of logistics has been created in the Ministry of Commerce to focus on different wings of logistics to ensure that cost of logistics to the industrial production process is reduced. Similarly, for the financial sectors, there are efforts to reduce the cost of financing where it's more than the international cost. But these things are coming, and we are getting the support from the industry. And I'm sure as we interact more, we become more professionals, things will turn around. And I'm hopeful that growth momentum, which has picked up in last 4 years, is only going to intensify. There are more things to come. We are seeing the inquiries. We are seeing the big international players coming in, trying to put their shops, our own engineers, students, and startups coming. They are innovating and getting into manufacturing process. And infrastructure also improving. I do hope things will move much further. But cooperation from all and everyone is required. Thank you.
Excellent keynote address. And I'd like to share with the Joint Secretary and also with the audience and my panelists that logistics, we've made significant improvements. For example, a truck which used to take 14, 15 days to reach Chennai from Delhi is now reaching in 5 to 6 days. Ahmedabad, in fact, which used to take 4 or 5 days, is now we are reaching overnight. And that is essentially because of GST. That's one very major growth. And I think power, there is substantial improvement, but I think still we have to go some distance. It's in the financial sector, and which is where the costs are high, of course, not for the global players, but for especially the Indian SMEs. And that is something which I think is getting addressed now in the NPE. So we are very, very grateful that that thing is being taken care of. The panel is very well balanced. We have from CDOT, Mr. Soundarakumar. Design is a very key element, and I think somewhere the clock stopped for India where telecom design was concerned. And we are still living in the past glory of what we had achieved some 25 years back. So I'd like Mr. Soundarakumar to talk about design and R&D, how we are planning to overcome this very important thing, a very important element of our our mix, which we have somehow missed. I'll give a small introduction of Mr. Soundarakumar also. He is the director, C. Bangalore, and has graduated from MIT Madras in 1983. He joined Engineers India first in 1983 and was responsible for establishing digital electrical control systems and instrumentation in India. He has been with C. Dot since 1986. Major contributions in C. Dot are establishment of transfer of technology and production process, where more than 40 manufacturers have got productization of C. Dot products. He's worked in all areas, including design development, deployment, and transfer of products. Over to you.
Thank you, sir, chairman, joint secretary, and my co-panelist, and my dear audience. Thank you very much for the organizers for giving such an opportunity. This is the first opportunity, but I had been attending this program for more than 4 years. I got an opportunity to share my experience, how we have faced, how we have resolved, and what is the challenge for Indian presently. And C. Dot, Center for Development of Telematics, it is an autonomous body established in 1984 with the support of the government. And the mandate first, it was given, 36 crore was given, and 36 month was given to develop a first digital exchange. And we could achieve that one in 1986, the first digital exchange indigenously developed and deployed. And the main reason is to connect this 32,000 villages to the urban community. So we have done it, and there is no slippage in that. Today's session, to talk about investment cycle, threat from imports and government support, make in India, learning from global mobile manufacturing, of course. I would like to share my developmental activities and manufacturing practices, which is more than 35 years without any doubt, we have created 91 manufacturers and more than 2,000 vendors in India. And about this high manufacturing cost, I will touch upon at the end. And to come to this extended investment cycle. So basically, the cycle for procurement, it is taking a longer time. One is in terms of sourcing the components, in terms of manufacturing, in terms of delivering and acceptance by the people. Apart from that, there are challenges with reference to assembly, testing, integration, dispatch, and installation, and commissioning. Everywhere there will be a delay, because whatever you expect, it may not happen. But of course, on the contrary, we have to meet the schedule. Without meeting the schedule, we will end up in paying the LD clauses. The second thing is the threat from imports. Yes, we require challenges. We are still importing the foreign equipments, no doubt about it. Whenever, wherever it is not there in India, we don't mind. We have to. First, digital exchange was 1986. At that time, not even a single pin was manufactured in India. But after that, we have created around 10 million lines were produced in India by Indian manufacturers, supported by various component vendors. But today, I can confidently tell that all these 10 million lines are being replaced by the next generation network, IP-based, and it is ready. This infrastructure is ready for taking up the 4G as well as 5G. You may be thinking that two-thirds of the equipment, whatever we are using in the network, is designed, developed by C. Dot and C. Dot manufacturers. And thanks to all our indigenous manufacturers and vendors from India as well as from foreign countries, it is a collective effort. So what I would like to bring up in this one, there is no threat, challenges are many, but opportunities are also many. We can share the cake, no doubt about it. Wherever, whichever is cheaper, whichever is suitable to the taste, please take it and then eat it, because it's a big pie we have, 5G. It is going to be a big pie. It is not a single manufacturer or a single vendors can meet up all the requirements, but we have to come collectively, who is capable of taking, what are the challenges, how we can meet up those things. Government support, thanks to government. I would like to remember the support given by the government. In 1986, the first digital exchange came. That first exchange got fired in the this one, rural automatic exchange, it was installed and there was a fire. But the support came from the government and said that this is the first time you are making the mistake, don't worry about it, go ahead. With that, we could produce 32,000 exchanges. A Racks Day program was successful because of the support. Another thing is, there was a policy from the government, below 10,000 lines, it is going to be indigenous technology only. The late Rajesh Pilot took that bold decision and supported indigenous technology. About 10,000 lines, yes, it was open to import the equipments. Because of that decision in 1990, today we can confidently tell that all the 7 million lines which is there in the network is indigenously developed, deployed with the support of the government. So there is no lack of support from the government. It is always there. If it is progressing well, government support is there fully. Coming to this, players are getting eliminated in the beginning, tenders itself. See, this is a major challenge indigenous manufacturers or developers are facing. Today, I am making the exchange, and first of all, it is going for the TEC evaluations, yes. Finally, there is one simple clause in the RFP. You should have tried this exchange in some XY country for 20,000 pieces. How can an indigenous manufacturer, how can an indigenous developed person go to the foreign country and test it and then validate it? My exchange is going to work in my country. So it has to be given for the support, it should be given for the indigenous manufacturers, no doubt. You put that condition, but you should not put some clauses that unless otherwise you meet this condition, you will not be in a position to participate in the tender. This type of things, our own people are creating problem for ourselves. So we should take care, we should support the people. We don't want any other, this one. We wanted the support. So this is about simple RFPs. We should take care, we should support the local manufacturing, local indigenously developed products. Then learning from global mobile manufacturing. I don't want to comment anything about the global manufacturing. What we have done for 35 years, I would like to share. So the first of all, make in India. I would like to tell that one in this forum, because every citizen of India should understand, what do you mean by make in India? Is it idea to create an IPR, or then design the product, or manufacture in India, but is it really happening in India? Every Indian should ask this question to yourself. The thing is, high manufacturing cost, because the challenges are there. That is long lead item. That is a component, if you are asking for a component, 52 weeks, 60 weeks. Memories are not available in India, because whereas I have to design a product, I have to take the approval and then deliver the product within 6 months. If the tender is coming, if I place an order within 6 months, how can you produce it and then deploy it? That is the biggest challenge, because component itself is not available. This type of long lead items. Second thing is volume price. Some of the MNCs, they have the fabs outside. They have a quota. Unless otherwise it is produced, it is given to me, don't give this component to anybody else. So our hands are tied up in this case. High component cost. In a distress purchase, people will go for immediately, I would like to have this much component within this period. So you pay this price. This is the highest component cost. Then shortest delivery period. Yes, delivery period is there for 6 months. And if it is not, the LD clauses will apply. So in the process, but can he make that balance, that profit? It is very difficult. These are all the critical factors. Indigenous component manufacturing for critical electronics components like ICs, optical transceivers are not available in India after 40 years. This is the saddest part. We don't have any fab in India, but we have all the capability. Our own Indians are making the fabs outside. Our own people are making the other softwares and then porting onto the components. But we have the capability, we don't have the infrastructure. Second thing is indigenous component manufacturers for low items like ceramic capacitors are not available in India. This is the saddest part. Simple component. Another say lack of PCB manufacturing. PCB manufacturing more than 20 layers, it is not available in India. We have to go for foreign countries. We have to pay through our nose. So these are all the components, unless otherwise the component industry is supported and given all the support from the government, and as well as from the other people, it is difficult. So finally, I would like to give my views, that is the R&D to manufacturing. It is unless otherwise you do the R&D, develop it in India, it is difficult. And then transfer of technology we have achieved. I am talking about my experience. The last one I would like to tell you, these are all the various partnerships we can do. We can do the joint development. Finally, what do you mean by make in India? This is my last slide. Everybody has to understand. Is it designed in India? It is designed for India. It is manufactured in India. Anybody is interested in doing the transfer of technology, sharing all the vendor information, manufacturing information, and lifetime support of the product. Unless otherwise it is made for India, made in India by Indians, and make in India, support for the lifetime of the product, it has to be given in India, not from anybody else will come and support. With this, I would like to thank all the people, and that indigenous is the only thing. It should be indigenously manufactured, developed, cost-effective solution, reliable solution, and it should be made in India. Then only we can succeed. And the challenges are many, but we have the skills. We have to develop our own skills for facing all the challenges. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I think these thoughts are valuable, but in a world of global supply chains, I don't know whether doing an end-to-end 360 kind of operation, which is as suggested, will be possible, because we can't isolate ourselves from the world. I'm infringing the ladies first principle because of my friend Carol Nissa. She's from the infrastructure sector, and I will go to Sanjiv Narayan now. Sanjiv is an old friend. Sanjiv is one of the leaders of the electronic industry, thought leaders of the electronic industry. He has been president of Elsina 30 years back and recently also. So a very long, illustrious career. He's an entrepreneur and has multiple plants in north and south of India, including a design center in both India and Germany. SGS is one of the largest exporters in India of electronic sub-assemblies and box products to EU countries. This is something we are really proud of. He was the chairman of the Electronic and Computer Software Export Promotion Council in 2007-09 also. And he has worked closely with all of us and with the government in policy making, and we value his inputs always. Sanjeev.
Thank you, Pankaj. I don't think I deserve the kind of introduction you did give me, but thank you all the same. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Chairman Pankaj, Mr. Sanjay Rakesh, my fellow panelists. I think this is a great forum where you have Mr. Sanjay Rakesh, the person who is responsible for government policies to really increase the manufacturing sector. And you have our chairman, Mr. Pankaj Mohindroo, who has spearheaded the great movement for mobile manufacturing in this country. What they together have been able to achieve is amazing. And this has really put electronics at the center stage. They have proved that given the right policies and import duty structures, it can be done. And over time, with a phased manufacturing program, depth of manufacturing can be increased. This has happened in spite of great opposition and disbelief. They were able to get this going, and this is because they were able to put all the players on the same page. A commendable effort, and I think Pankaj and Sanjay Rakesh both deserve a real round of applause for this. Thank you. The concept has been proved. And now we need to deploy this horizontally to cover other verticals. And if you ask me, preferably the entire electronics sector. Electronics, we must understand and realize that, you know, it cuts across all aspects of life, all industry segments, and is all pervading. What I believe is that why can't we make electronics as a point of national importance, a priority? You know, if you look around all over the world, countries which have succeeded have done so, and today they are reaping the benefits of this policy. So my request, sir, would be that we should once again try and see if we can get electronics as a national priority so that it is given a very special status. As my fellow panelists have said, you know, vanilla manufacturing has very thin margins and the competition is acute. We have to recognize the disabilities which exist in this country. They can't be wished away. They will take time. The lack of component infrastructure, I think, is a very major issue, and this ecosystem does require a duty cover. If we want to get into manufacturing, the duty cover becomes very critical. Also, you know, the next level of manufacturing is the component level. And components are far more capital intensive and also long gestation. Now, when we're looking at long gestation, investments are going to come in when there is a clear roadmap. I strongly believe that we should put together a roadmap of 10 years where there's a clear statement saying that what we are going to encourage and what we are going to protect is local manufacturing. If that happens, then you would see a lot of support that will be coming in as far as investments in the component sector is concerned. Also, you have to understand that, you know, when we are talking about capital intensive and we are talking about capital costs, we need the private equity players to start getting excited about the hardware manufacturing, just the same way they are excited about the software. To bring in this, I think it's very important that this roadmap is made and we can publicize this roadmap, because unless they see a clear roadmap, they're not going to put their money in here. Well, this is as far as the high volume manufacturing is concerned, but parallelly, we also need to add high value add manufacturing. The products that are innovative, cost effective, and are able to compete with existing technologies. We have to use the demographic dividend that we have in terms of both the hardware and software skills and how we can leverage this. Here I have two suggestions in terms of a dual strategy. One is that the existing MSME companies who have to tie up with companies who have technology products, especially from developed countries, in terms of a joint venture or technical tie-ups. This could be in the areas of energy storage, energy usage, electric vehicle drives and controls, security solutions, medical, solar, agricultural, etc., etc. You know, there are a large number of companies, especially in Europe, where their economies have become high-cost economies and they have had problems with terms of their own manufacturing. And they've been focusing now on developing really new technologies and more efficient products. They do not have the scale. And if we in India, in terms of the market, leverage this, and we can tie up with such companies and bring in those products into India, we can leapfrog. They get the scale, we get the technology, and we will be able to then market this globally. The other area is the startups. You know, we've been talking about startups, we're talking digital India. But I think the kind of problems startups in electronics are facing are very different. Any startup in electronics, they have great ideas, they have great solutions. But when it comes to electronics, they have to source over 100 components. They have to assemble these components, test them, and then they would have to go in through several iterative processes before they can come up with a product. I think what is important is, what can we do to support this startup? And I here have a suggestion that here the industry association, leading distributors, global distributors, and government, if we can come together and create some kind of a forum where these people can be helped. And I think that will be a big service for us, how we can move forward and accelerate the growth here. So to sum up, I would say that let's replicate the mobile model in other verticals, and if possible, in entire electronics, and let's announce a 10-year map. The MSMEs to try and tie up with joint ventures or technical tie-ups with companies which have new technologies in various areas and bring that here to India. And also get into supporting the startups by providing them what they are not good at, which is sourcing and assembly processes. Thank you.
That was wonderful, Sanjiv. And some of your thoughts are extremely valuable as always, and we'll work hard to see that they are implemented. But I think the great thought was that we must have a 10-year plan. I think nations, industries must plan for the long term. And I'm sure that is something we are taking stock of, and the Joint Secretary is taking stock of. I move on to Carol Nissa, who is the Executive Director of World Trade Center. Which is the area of infrastructure, which is so important. I think the first round of mobile phone manufacturing did not happen in greenfield areas, because we had remnants of old infrastructure available with us. We had, you know, the NCR area had some facilities available. So quickly we went there, and, you know, the things have started. But to become a global leader, we have to have globally benchmarked infrastructure. The Joint Secretary spoke about logistics and power. And besides that, I think the important thing is that if we want to benchmark with China and Vietnam, which I'm sure we want to do, we have to have a string of incentives for the next 10 years which supports infrastructure. Where we can have a level playing field with these countries. A small introduction of Carol Nissa. She's spearheading the World Trade Center Services Division and is one of the instruments of the launch of the MOX initiative, which is the mobile exchange. She's forever forging new strategic partnerships. Her main responsibility is today identifying new opportunities for revenue growth. Khair is a master's in business management with a specialization in international marketing from University of Leeds. I think she has a key responsibility of giving the cutting edge to India's infrastructure requirements for the mobile phone and the electronic sector. And we look forward to her leadership in doing that.
Thank you, Pankaj. Good afternoon, everyone. and my panelists. It's a great honor to be here. More important is that I would be actually be talking about World Trade Center and also about the initiative of the World Trade Center. Our journey of World Trade Center in India is very important to understand why we are doing what we are doing here. As a global organization, we are present in 330 cities in 120 countries. And our main objective of each and every World Trade Center, of all these 330 World Trade Centers, is to grow trade. We are a not-for-profit organization, and we are working very closely with both the central and the state governments to actually facilitate trade. Now, when we started in India, we started in 2013, and it's not been a very long journey in India, but it has been a very, very good experience in India, wherein we have made a lot of inroads and a lot of successes in many states, especially now 11 states, with India having 26 World Trade Centers, and each World Trade Center is going to be different. What we actually talk about when we're talking about facilitating trade, we are talking about offering not only services, but also infrastructure. For us, it is like a body and a soul. So our first World Trade Center was in north of India, which was in the state of UP, Uttar Pradesh, or in the city of Noida. And it started out as a 2.1 million square feet of infrastructure. But today, by 2019, we are 150 plus acres, or more than 16 million square feet of infrastructure, which is focused on the ESDM industry, the electronic system design manufacturing industry. Whenever you hear about World Trade Center, and unfortunately, 9/11, which is, today would say it's a global tragedy, is actually been the reason for our recognition. But in India, we've been providing the state of art infrastructure everywhere globally. In India, when we started in Noida, we realized that ESDM industry was going to be the poster boy industry, especially with the mobile industry. That is the industry which is going to be contributing to the economy. With the government initiatives of Make in India and Digital India and Startup India and Skill India, we would be able to take this industry to another level. But the problems, like the joint secretary, the honorable joint secretary actually mentioned, was where we needed to step up, especially the ecosystem. Whenever we would talk about the ecosystem and the ecosystem being in a nascent state, we realized the ecosystem is in a nascent stage, but where can it come? Where can this ecosystem grow? Because this ecosystem does not just need to come and establish itself, but also needs to grow. So where was the ecosystem, the infrastructure which was required? So we thought that we would provide with that marketplace, with that kind of environment or that integrated development which is required for this ecosystem to actually come up. We facilitated a lot of companies into India, especially in this industry. Vivo, Oppo, we've been instrument, Foxconn. We've played our role in getting those investments thanks to various World Trade Centers. We've helped in a lot of joint ventures when it has come to technology adoptions. We have played our little bit of role in few companies were instrumental in helping develop this industry. But we realized that innovation was really, really lacking in India. There was a lot more to be done. So what did World Trade Center do? We provided not only the infrastructure, but we actually did a joint venture wherein we actually did a tie-up ourselves with UK's largest accelerator to facilitate the innovative environment of the startups, especially in the ESDM. For skills, we actually tied up with Center of Excellences, not just partner with Indian companies, but also with various technology partners from the World Trade Center network, wherein we have 1 billion businesses connected. We actually use that those connections and that network to actually get the industry and create our own ecosystem in our own way. We take pride in the fact that we provide access to 3 M's, which is what the Indian SMEs or the manufacturers actually require. That 3 M's is access to money, market, and mentors. So we have been providing and we have been working in providing the access to money, market, and mentors, because while facilitating trade and facilitating international investment is one of the agendas that the World Trade Center has globally, but World Trade Center is also working on creating and helping build Indian champions. And this is a phrase which actually my friend Pankaj has actually coined and has been pushing me to actually work towards building Indian champions, because this, as an Indian, is the least we can do to contribute to this industry. So we have been trying to, we have an in-house NBFC, which actually provides financial support to SMEs. We have an accelerator, in-house accelerator to promote innovation. We are also providing, and we have the markets through the World Trade Center. While we are providing these services, which are facilitation, but we are also talking about an infrastructure, which is very integrated. We have very state-of-art A-grade assembly lines for the mobile manufacturing, for the manufacturing of other companies which would be setting up. We also have offices, we have adapt-to-suit workspaces, and our infrastructure is actually built on the principles of temples, and we call them temples of work, because we have workspaces which are catering to an assembly, we've got workspaces which are catering to IT companies and software companies, which are very, very adaptive and very, very dynamic. At the same time, we realize that if large companies are to come up or large enterprises are to come up, there's housing which is required. This housing would be required for blue collars. Dormitories would be required by blue collars. But at the same time, there would also be another spectrum. Just like in a temple, you have you're actually catering to an entire spectrum of a poor middle class and a very rich and an affordable section. So we are providing an exact kind of an infrastructure which is required by all the categories in the industry. So we've got housing. We are right now working with the government of UP, where we are actually asking for a larger housing percentage. Reason being, because large enterprises would have large employment, and they would require large number of housing. So we are actually providing them with all of those integrated facilities. And these are all state of art and a global addresses that we, as a World Trade Center, we are a global address recognized all over the world, at least in 330 cities and 120 countries. So one, the SMEs, the Indian SMEs get an advantage of having an international address, plus having a state-of-art infrastructure. But having said that, but we are also facilitating, like the Joint Secretary mentioned, that we are talking about ease of doing business. The ease of doing business is what we have taken very seriously. We provide end-to-end facilitation of companies, whether it is a small company or a large enterprise, in setting up their businesses. Our tagline to these manufacturing enterprises is, just manufacture. That, just do your business. The rest we will take care of. The compliances, the land compliances, the other compliances which are required by the industries, you do not worry about them. That is our headache to take care of. You just do what you are supposed to do. That is produce, manufacture, do business. When it comes to connectivity, technology adoptions, we are leading the way. We are actually helping companies, because we have World Trade Centers all across, especially in the electronic hubs. We have the World Trade Centers. So we have companies who are interested in coming up base in India, either directly or through partners. So we are the connectors. We are facilitating. We are bridging them. So ease of doing business is one of the ecosystem, is a part of the ecosystem and the infrastructure that which we are providing. So India is huge. The challenges are huge, but there are huge opportunities. And there are, and the intent of the Prime Minister and the initiatives of the government with Make in India, Digital India, Startup India, they might have their own set of problems, but they have also given a lot of good things to India. And one of them is what we have all been working together for, the World Trade Center. The mandate by the Prime Minister for all the smart cities is that each and every smart city is to have a World Trade Center, largely because we are facilitating businesses. We are providing that ecosystem. We are tailor-making our services, which are actually helping facilitate and grow businesses. And lastly, I would say that the dependence, the technology dependence that we actually see of Indian companies, I mean, there's a misnomer. There's a lot which the Indian companies are doing on their own. Right now, this is the time and the period. And this is a period where we see a lot of public-private partnerships happening. Like the World Trade Center, with their initiative of MOCs, is a public-private initiative. The government of India, the government of UP, and a private entity like World Trade Center have come together to provide not only the ecosystem and the infrastructure and the services, but are working very closely to help this industry grow. Thank you so much for this opportunity.
Brilliant, Caroline. You never lose an opportunity to push your organization, which is excellent. I think we should all do that. Our last speaker is from a sector which is very critical for electronic manufacturing. And this is the least fashionable sector. But they do a very valiant job of the non-fashionable side of the industry. They are the EMS companies who put things together. And riding on them, brands are able to do what they have to do with the least amount of issues. Deepak Thakkar, Dr. Deepak Thakkar is the Vice President, Business Development of Flex Industries. Deepak. I'll give you a small introduction of Deepak. He's the Business Development Head for Flex and leads the India Business and E-Mobility platform, leading a team responsible for driving the Flex sketch-to-scale platform in India, delivering competitiveness, global manufacturing efficiencies, and supply chain velocity, which is so important. Flextronics, among other things, is a giant manufacturer of mobile phones and chargers and many other things. Over to you, Deepak.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that. Let me first start by saying thank you for inviting us for this event. I know it kind of sounds like, all speakers come up here and say, thank you for inviting. I know they mean it, but I just want to say I especially do definitely mean it. And the reason I say that is Convergence is not just a conference where you come in, do your own presentation, do a little bit of pitch, and you go home. This is a place where you get to come and see the progress that has been made in this sector, which is tangible, perceptible, throbbing, growth that we're seeing in the last couple of years. Every time I'm here at Convergence, just walking the halls, when you go to the exhibit areas all the way to, of course, any one of the individual sessions, you can feel the energy, and that is super critical. This is not just business as usual. This is something different. And so to be invited as a representative from Flex as part of this, super honorable. And of course, it's always an honor to be in presence of the Joint Secretary. Thank you very much for being here, and thank you for making us be part of this panel as well. So I was kind of working on my talking points, not so much a presentation or anything, but I was working on my talking points, and I started thinking about Convergence from last year. And I said, well, to talk about things moving forward, it's a good idea to take maybe just a quick step back and see where we came from, right? So last year, right about at this time, we were talking about two main topics. We were talking about changes in import duties, et cetera, for a couple of sectors, mobile phones especially, and set-top boxes. And look where we've come from that point on till today. By many estimates, India is now the second largest mobile phone manufacturer in the world. over 250 million units being manufactured in India per year. I think probably more, but that's a conservative number. Set-top boxes, the manufacturing of those platforms in India, and smart set-top boxes and direct-to-cable set-top boxes. That market has grown tremendously, and I expect that market to continue growing, of course, with keeping in mind some of the changes in the digital infrastructure and just the way in which consumers are consuming that particular product. So when you look at that progress, you start thinking, okay, then what's next? What is the next evolution of growth, right? What comes next? So I start thinking about things like, do we have the right momentum? I think there is, right? The momentum is going in the right direction. There is positive government policy, no doubt about that. There is a growth in the number of startups producing some really exciting products for both local consumption and for exports, so that's a good thing. Clearly great macroeconomic conditions for India's growth, that's a good thing. There is increase in the number of middle class in India and in the regions surrounding India for export, so that's a good thing. Financial policy, that is not governed locally, that is a global phenomenon, and so that cannot be mandated or wished away. That is just something that one has to work with. But you start looking at all of the factors that promote growth in not just electronics, but in all of the adjacent fields, and I feel India is definitely going in the right direction. The momentum is going in the right direction. So then what's next? Are we going to make more set-top boxes? Are we going to make more mobile phones? For sure, why not? We'll probably design them all here. Maybe there will be more of a growth towards having localized components, localized designs, and of course, maybe a net exporter as opposed to an importer of many of these solutions. Why not? But then what comes next? So I was at CES earlier this year, just a couple of weeks back, and I started thinking, look at the products I'm looking at there, right? IoT connected just about everything. IoT connected appliances for the home, IoT connected baby monitors, IoT connected showers, IoT connected taps, bathtubs, baby monitors, air monitoring systems, water monitoring systems. All of these, as Sanjiv said earlier, require electronics. Electronics is something that crosses across multiple market segments, and all of those require a board to be built, components to be placed, testing to be done, box build to be performed, testing to be completed on that, and then shipped to the end customer. Why can all of that not be made in India? It can. It absolutely can. It can be designed in India through any one of these companies that are represented here on the dais and many others, including Flex. Components can be procured locally and some imported in. Box build can be performed here in India, and of course, all of these solutions that we just talked about have a net market here in India, which is growing. There's over 1 billion people. There's over 400 million people that form the middle class. They're all consuming products. Tomorrow's products are being manufactured elsewhere and imported in. They can very easily be manufactured here. A couple months back, I started looking at yet another market, which I think could be a huge growth area for electronics here in India, and that is the e-mobility market segment. This is a market segment that I lead for the company globally, and I started thinking about how in India we can potentially benefit from involvement in that sector. Electric scooters, that's going to be a $1 billion market in India in the next 4 years. Well, guess what? Electric scooters need electronics. They need mechanicals, they need system assembly, and no, they cannot be bought in a different part of the world and shipped in. They need to be made locally because of the form factors. We're helping companies do that. I think that is a growth area. How about medical wheelchairs, electric scooters, electric bikes? These are all areas that are growing globally, and due to the demand of clean energy in India and in the growth in the middle class, requiring the fact that we need to have cleaner products, more sustainable products, some of these will become more mainstay. So I think, you know, for the remainder of the time that we have in the session today, what I'd like to do is really have a discussion around how can we move up the value chain. It's not so much about can we make these products in India. Yes, we can. We just have to be committed to the fact that the design of these products can happen here, supply chain can be sourced here, and companies like Flex and others can help make these products for the local market and also use this market as a export base. So if someone were to ask me, give us two markets that you think are going to grow dramatically in India in the next few years, I think e-mobility is one of them. And the second one is anything IoT connected. So I certainly hope that next year when I'm back here at Convergence, if I'm given an opportunity to come here and present, I'd love to talk to you guys about what is the growth from this point on to next point that we've accomplished. So let's talk about how we move up the value chain, and these are some of the markets we can focus on. Thank you.
I think that was a very useful perspective, and I must give credit to the organizers that the panel is so well balanced. There's a policy leader, a global EMS player, a local Indian entrepreneur who's, you know, doing products, somebody from infrastructure, and somebody from the design, this thing. So it's very well balanced and well, you know, everybody's articulated it so beautifully. So I think the last 5 minutes, if I'll open it for questions, if the audience has any questions, and if any of the panelists want to give last minute thoughts which they may have missed, which may have developed over the last 1 hour or so. So any questions from the audience, please?
So I really appreciate the knowledge which panel brings here. So now we discuss about the electronics manufacturing. The one thing the industry moving about the smart electronics, so IoT is one aspect of that. Apart from that, you know, the artificial intelligence and robotics, it will also integrate with electronics. So what is the vision about, particularly from the government of India, from integration of artificial intelligence and robotics with the electronics world? You know, because without electronics is the base of robotics. And the China has done so well, and they have a full-fledged 2025 plan. And since last, I track China market also.
Yes.
The kind of huge projects they have launched for the robotics in Japan. Yes. So I don't see that kind of traction coming on from the government. You know, though some vision document has come out from Niti Aayog. So maybe from Sanjay sir, we can. Maybe from other panelists also.
Technically, he's the keynote speaker, not a panelist. So, but I will, if he allows, then.
Thank you. Actually, what you are saying is, if we put it simply, it's a merging of software and hardware, which is coming up. But technically, it's a three parts. One is automation, which is a robotics. Second is artificial intelligence, and third is IoT. Now, we also have the plans, because it's a merger of software and hardware both put together. Now, that is going on. There are steps which a government of India is also taking. Niti Aayog has come up with visions. And we have several center of excellences which are working on in this field. If we say artificial intelligence, it's very generic. There are several aspects of artificial intelligence, be it linguistic, be it behavioral, be it signal capturing and all that. So different sectors, different wings or different institutions are working where government is putting the support, both in terms of policy and also in terms of financial resources which is coming up. So we are aware of the challenges which are coming in the future, trying to take the steps. But yes, China has taken massive steps, probably because they have massive resources and huge ambition to take on for next 5-7 years. So our interventions are not of that scale, but there are interventions, and there are significant interventions which are being made by the government, supported by the academia, industry, and the startup ecosystem of the country.
Any other question? Yes, please. Yes.
As Mr. Sanjay Rakesh has said, there should be 10 years planned for the local manufacturer unit improvements. So can government subsidized approach will be helpful to increase the mass manufacturing technology, technological equipment, such as we can see in the agriculture equipments that government is providing a huge amount of subsidy on those equipments. Thank you.
Can you elaborate a little bit, because I could not get what is the subsidy which you are referring to and which manufacturing?
For the electric component manufacturing technologies.
Electric component manufacturing. Yes. Yes. It's a, this thought is there. It's a part of our new electronic policy, which is likely to come very shortly, that we had circulated the draft. The challenges with the component manufacturing is that the manufacturer of the component across the world are subjected to same custom duty. Domestic protection is not available. Now, because it's a small and high value item, shipping also is not a challenge. So it gets concentrated wherever there is a good ecosystem. We understand the challenges. We have some people who have survived this critical conditions and they have built component manufacturing ecosystem at a smaller scale. So taking the cue, we are working on giving support to such manufacturer and inviting new manufacturer for the component building ecosystem. So that will come up.
Any other questions, please? Okay, so a few interventions I'll make very quickly. One was the Joint Secretary in his keynote address raised a very important point, which I'm taking home, which I think is very valid, and industry associations, by and large, are very guilty of that. That come what may, we do not intervene when we have information about one of the members or participants going rogue. So at least our conscience is clear that, you know, we are very balanced as far as the interest of the nation is concerned and the interest of the industry is concerned. But what I'd like to advise the Joint Secretary and all of you is that this is admittedly a very big weakness of the country. And I think this has created a huge amount of mistrust, and the rogue elements bring down the entire dispensation to the lowest common multiplier, and the risk-taking of the government system goes for a six. And that hurts the nation. So, but I think this is more of a spiritual call. I don't know whether it can be put into a law or something like that. But I think as far as governance of industry associations, there's definitely a few things which Sanjiv and I will work on. That, you know, I don't know whether we have the resources to do that, but I'm sure the JS will be, you know, loosen the purse strings a little for some of the associations to be able to build infrastructure to be able to monitor this better. It's just an idea. This was one very important thing which I picked up from his keynote address. You would like to say something?
I'll just add here, I'll just clarify if I failed to. It does not require the investment of resources, nor does it require kind of active pursuing somebody who has done some wrong or something. Okay, okay. It's a kind of social ostracization or social sanction is one.
Right, right.
Secondly, letting other side know, even if it's through informal channels or something, is that something is going on wrong.
Yes.
So that before it becomes a very large magnitude of being called as a scam and all, some corrective action can be taken. So that is the understanding. We don't want that kind of pursuing something, but it's a kind of like, if it hurt the interest of association or the industry as a whole, then it's natural for a human being to react.
Yes.
Suppressing that reaction is deliberate. I just want the natural reaction. If it comes out, it will help other side to catch before it.
Yes, yes, yes. Any other interventions?
I also,
yes.
think that one of the things which Mr. Sanjiv Narayan actually mentioned was that the electronic industry should actually be given, it should be looked into, that it should be given as a special status. That is something that I would actually like to leave this dais with, that is a special request to be considered, and it can actually help the industry, especially in building up the Indian champions. Yours, mandate, which I'm taking.
Deepak, any last thoughts?
No, really, I think, most of the points have been covered well. I think, clearly having this the Joint Secretary here at this event, it really does make a big difference because, growth in any industry is definitely dependent on a variety of factors, macroeconomic conditions for sure, local demand for sure, funding, startups, all of it. But in the end, government policy is definitely an attention onto that industry. It's a good thing, and that clearly drives things in the positive direction. We've seen that, right? Yes, yes. We have some great examples.
No, I was
of
so
it.
Glad that you mentioned exports.
Yeah.
And I was complaining in the afternoon to the secretary and the JS that I'm struggling. I think it's your Indianness which brings that out. And I'm sure Flex also is very serious about it.
Yeah, no, but absolutely. I mean, look, we're at the mercy of our customers. If our customers tell us that this is a region that is ripe for net exports, we are definitely going to do the right thing.
Yes.
And yes, my Indianness is definitely very critical, for sure. And I'm very proud of that. So, yes, indeed.
I think that is India's greatest export, people like you well, in the Silicon Valley.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate that.
Pankaj, I just want to...
Sir.
Add one thing that, see, ultimately, we need to integrate with the global value chain. Long term, that's the only solution. All what we are suggesting for the next 10-year plan is only to get on to that level. Ultimately, subsidies are not a solution to the problem.
Absolutely.
So we must make sure that we become strong and we are able to compete with the products. And I was personally very happy to listen to your presentation, ma'am, that World Trade Center is giving so much. So maybe one of the thoughts that I had is that we can build an infrastructure of component supply to help the startup ecosystem write what you're already doing. Because that will be a big, big help to the startups, because I've seen so many of them struggling. They have great ideas, but they're not able to get out in spite of the incubation centers, because incubation centers is only providing them an infrastructure. But component sourcing is a real pain. And we must try and solve that problem. Yeah, I think it's really great. It was a good eye-opener for me. I didn't know all this that you were doing.
Unfortunately, I was not able to showcase the infrastructure here for you to see. But then seeing is believing. I would like to invite you all to the World Trade Center, Noida.
Maybe we should do that.
Yes.
Because, and frankly, it was a real eye-opener for me. Sitting right here in Delhi, I was not aware of it.
Great. I mean, I think that's a takeaway for me.
Sir, Korea, and we'll all come with you. Let's do that.
Vivo has a large plant there also.
Okay. So let's, it's just an eye-opener for the, I'll get more people from our industry.
I mean, how about tomorrow? I'm more than happy to welcome you tomorrow.
Yeah, okay. We'll take one question.
Good evening, sir. We can see that the boom of IoT is coming through, and a lot of youth is taking interest in this, making startups and participating in this wave. But the thing is, the current education system, like the engineering course of BE, which we are taking through. So I don't see it as efficient for the upcoming need or the requirement of current situations. So what would you like to suggest current youth to, I mean, what kind of studies they should take or what kind of steps they should take to equally contribute to the IoT wave and the need of current...
I request the Joint Secretary to take this.
I will take it.
Okay, please.
Yes.
First of all, whatever you are studying there, it is I mean, very difficult to bring it to the curriculum and then come forward. Instead, in many places, we can reskill the people. That is, once they finish their courses, there will be a 3 months course or 6 months course, what is required for doing the job. That type of reskilling is possible. And then many programs, government programs are software, hardware. In fact, I myself have developed more than a lakh people, reskilled them, and they are working in Wipro, Cognizant, and other side. See, whether you are fit for the job, for that, what type of job you are going to do, you have to prepare. Coming to this smart cities. Smart cities, there is a huge opportunity. There is a hardware, there is a software, and applications. See, only thing is you should know the language, how to write the software. So, and CDOT, we have developed a common service platform. That is, irrespective of the application, irrespective of the devices, it can be hooked onto the common service platform with which it will identify which application it has to be rooted, where it has to be connected. So it is not a vendor dependent, it is a common service, one M2M platform we have created that is open to the people like entrepreneurs or anybody who would like to come and then test their applications, and we can help you in integrating it so that different type of applications can be hooked on. Finally, when you are going for a system, that is for a IoT, M2M or a smart city, what is required is the system integrator should know that what application you have written and then what are all the various applications required, and the common service platform can be used so that multiple vendors, multiple applications can be clubbed. So IoT, M2M doesn't require a big infrastructure or incubator center or something. Simple, you require one PC, and with a skill, you can do that application-oriented things. Students, straight away, they can get into this. So we can support, CDOT can support this type of activities, and we have the test beds, you can come and then approach us.
Thank you.
I'll just say why I said no, I can't tell you. I do believe and I do feel that there is a need to change the current style of teaching for the engineering in your system to match the what you said is emerging style of life. And but this is not in my jurisdiction. The syllabus patterns and etc. dealt by somebody else, some other ministry. And I would not be the competent to comment whether that should be changed and to what extent it should be changed. So that is the reason, because this question was put, whether the style of teaching should be changed. Personally, I do feel it should be changed. But being as a representative of government, I have no mandate to intervene and say that. Thank you.
Yes, thank
you. I think with this, I'd like to thank the keynote speaker and all the panelists and the wonderful audience and the organizers for having us all here. I'll bring the session to an end. You have some presents for us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, panelists, for your valuable in-depth knowledge. We are charmed by your sharp fluency. With this, we come to an end of yet another spectacular session. We sincerely value your inputs and appreciate the time and efforts involved on your part to contribute to the success of the session. Thanks to all our delegates for the patience hearing. May I now request Mr. Pankaj Mohindroo to present the mementos as a token of appreciation to our distinguished panelists. Shri Sanjay Kumar Rakesh. Dr. Deepak Thakkar. Mr. Sanjiv Narayan. Ms. Khair, Nissa. Mr. M. Soundarakumar. Now may I please request my colleague, Mrs. Aarti, to please come on stage and present the memento as a token of appreciation to our chairperson, Mr. Pankaj Mohindroo.